As crystal bridges in the Momentary, we recognize our role as settlers and guests in the Northwest Arkansas region. We acknowledge the Caddo, Quapaw, and Osage, as well as the many indigenous caretakers of this land and water. We appreciate the enduring influence of the vibrant, diverse, and contemporary cultures of indigenous peoples. We are conscious of the role in colonization that museums have played. As cultural institutions, we have a responsibility to engage in the dismantling of historical and systemic invisibility of indigenous peoples' past, present, and future. We choose to intentionally hold ourselves accountable to appropriate conversation, representation, connection, and education to facilitate a space of measurable change.
Hello, and welcome to our series, Lunch with Live in America. My name is Cynthia Post Hunt, and I'm the programmer for dance and theater at the Momentary. So today I'm here with Carra Martinez and the director of Live in America, of course, and our facilitator from Puerto Rico, Marina Reyes Franco. And today we are eating salad and sandwiches.
Two things. We're really up on our game. Welcome to Lunch with Live in America. I'm Carra Martinez. I'm the director of Live in America. And in this series, we're meeting with the folks that will be a part of the Live in America Festival at the Momentary in October of 2021. Live in America is a new festival that celebrates the power and the potency and the joy of lots of different communities coming together to share their performance histories and traditions and cultures. We have communities coming from across the US, dipping a bit into Mexico and also into its territories, including Puerto Rico, which is here with us today. This is our last community to be in conversation with. I'm not saying that we save the best for last, but it is the last. So, you know, you make of this what you will. Marina is with us here today, and I'll let her introduce herself.
Hi, thank you, Cynthia and Carra, for the invitation to lunch. My name is Marina Reyes Franco. I'm a curator at the MAC, which is the Museum of Contemporary Art in Puerto Rico, and I am a facilitator based in San Juan, Puerto Rico. Really excited to be here and talk to you.
I am super excited about this conversation because of in visiting all these communities, like in some ways my learning curve had to be the sharpest and the fastest and the most self-aware when visiting San Juan. And Marina is such a holder of that history. So we're gonna dig into some history today. We're gonna start with this, what is perhaps the most complex answer that you will hear to this question. Which is exciting to hear different levels of complexity around it. Marina, when I say America, America, what does that mean to you?
Yeah, well, I'm glad you did that pronunciation because it really depends how you pronounce it. In Spanish, America and America have two complete different feelings and meanings when said in Puerto Rico or being like enunciated by a Puerto Rican. I think that as I've mentioned before in conversations with you both, I think that like Puerto Rico exists in this weird Venn diagram. Not just are we kind of in the central part of the, you know, the continent that is the Americas, but we're not part of Central America. We are not Costa Rica, and we're not, like, we belong to the United States, but we are not a part of the United States in a real, like, legal form that is recognized by the Supreme Court. It's right that that's the way that it has been described in legal opinions since the early 20th century. So America is really complicated for us because we can say that we feel that we are part of Latin America, that we are part of the, that we are located in the Caribbean. We are a Latin American country. But then whenever I submit a text, I get it back because we're not a country. So I get that fact check constantly. No, your territory. So Puerto Rico is a territory that is a part of, but does not, no, that is, that belongs to, but it's not a part of the United States. And depending on whether you say America or America, that is how it will be, you know, that is how belonging will be perceived. What it means to, what it means to me, I mean, having lived, and also like having lived in Latin America, in Chile and in Argentina, it was also a constant negotiation of like having to explain what we were, I mean, what Puerto Rico is and what Puerto Rican feels like. And I was constantly being told that I was Yankee, or that or that I was gringa or whatever. Not really gringa, but Yankee. That's how they refer to it. So for me, and for a lot of people from Latin America and from Puerto Rico, when people from the United States say America, we're like, hey, that is not just yours. Like that name is not only, can't only refer to the United States. America is like, it's the whole continent. It's the Americas. It's everybody here. It's everybody like on this side of the world.
I love it. Well, you're kind of headed there. So I'm going to ask this kind of, it opens up a lot of histories. Can you share with folks like this movement between these two pronunciations also has to do with colonization, right? It's like, it comes hand in hand. Can you just walk us through however you like that particular history, especially in relationship to the United States? Because I don't, you know, I think my gut says that most people in the US are probably like, oh, they wanna be a state, or it's so great to be a US territory, which is maybe not accurate. Can you just take us there?
Yeah, sure. And actually it's really timely. During this week, there's actually like two bills in Congress, like one in the House, Nidia Velázquez and AOC presented it, and in the Senate, I'm not exactly who presented it, but I know that Bernie Sanders was co-sponsoring it. There is a Puerto Rican like self-determination act being discussed. And you know, every couple of years there is this like, you know, push for a referendum or something that will finally decide the fate of where we're headed. But so let's start with, you know, in the beginning, Puerto Rico was populated by, you know, indigenous peoples that were kind of decimated by colonization by the Spanish. And that happened between 1493 and 1898. In 1898, the local, I am skipping, you know, like centuries of history.
Yeah, it's but, okay.
But to get to the American century, what happened was that we were under Spanish rule. We had already negotiated self-rule, basically. So we were declared like an autonomous territory within the Spanish crown. And exactly at that moment, conveniently, a ship, an American, like a U.S. ship was exploded in a bay in Cuba. And Cuba was also another territory of Spain at the time, as was the Philippines as well. So that started the Spanish-American War in 1898. So the US was like, ah, this is, you know, they called it like a splendid little war. It was really like spearheaded by a lot of like media barons at the time, like the Hearst you know, media empire, everybody was pushing for this to happen. It was a way of the US like really declaring itself like a new kind of empire in the world, a new world power. And in May 1898, we started getting bombarded by US ships. And then around in July 25, 1898, we were invaded and occupied. And since then, like, Puerto Rico has been intensely militarized, and a lot of military bases, like whether it was Navy, Army, or, you know, Air Force, were established around the main island of Puerto Rico and two other islands that are part of Puerto Rico that are called Vieques and Culebra. Those were intensely militarized, and, you know, throughout the 20th century, particularly during the Cold War, they were used for like NATO exercises. So these places, these military bases were used, particularly Navy bases were used both by the US and like allied forces to just like practice dropping napalm or like, you know, plutonium, uranium, whatever. but that's like, we had military rule for a couple of years right after the invasion. And then between 1900 and 1917, we went through like some different changes in how we were like legally perceived by the US, until eventually we were like granted citizenship. So now like everybody that I'm not sure if exactly everybody that is born here can claim US citizenship. I'm not exactly sure about that, but I know that like I, as a like Puerto Rican born here to a mother that also had citizenship. So like it just gets passed along. And yeah. so like between 1917 and, well, actually 1900 and 1944, we were governed by US like governors, like people that were appointed directly by the president of the US. And then in 1944, the last guy that was appointed by a US president directly was the first Puerto Rican to be appointed. And then we had our first elections in 1948. And that eventually led to a constitution being established in 1952. That constitution is actually Act 600 of 1952 in the US Congress. So like our constitution was kind of accepted and voted on by the US Congress, which is very weird as a like a self-determination thing. And basically since then, nothing has fundamentally changed in terms of like our governance, except for changes in how like how the tax laws, like the IRS regulations might apply or not to US corporations operating out of Puerto Rico. That is something that has really affected the economy, but it's not something that has fundamentally changed our system of governance. But because of several economic crises, Puerto Rico basically went into like deep, deep debt with bondholders that include both Puerto Rican bondholders and foreigners, or like US-based bondholders and hedge funds and vulture funds, et cetera. So around 2015, basically, it was like, yeah, like we can't pay this debt. And enable Puerto Rico to declare bankruptcy, the Obama administration and the Republican-controlled Congress decided that the way to go was to establish the Fiscal Oversight and Management Board for Puerto Rico. That is basically a fiscal control board that kind of tells us how we can spend our money. Yeah. And so that is something that has like really fundamentally changed how the government operates, because we can't really say where we want the money to go. And it needs to go through these like approval processes. And then there are several court cases involved with different kinds of bondholders wanting to get their money back or their investment bank back. The main issue is that some people paid like 8 cents on the dollar, but they want the whole dollar with interest. And then there's people that really invested $1 and they want their dollar back.
So if you're visiting Puerto Rico, you're meeting with artists. The thing is, you, like the thing that I learned quickly, or I guess I grew up with code switching. So I had a sense of like how it works. I know how it works. And then if I'm working with different communities, then you learn that history and you watch and you pick up on the codes and when you yourself are switching in and out. But Puerto Rico was like a whole different thing. It was like, I don't know how to switch. I don't know what the codes are. I don't know what the histories are. But when you're working with like, or talking with Puerto Rican artists, like all that Marina just shared is on the table and it will inevitably become a part of the conversation. So you need to wrap your mind as best you can around Puerto Rican history and understand that as indigenous history, as fiscal history, as United States colonization, as contemporary, like, we wouldn't call it foreign policy. I don't even know what we would call, like in the case, territorial policy.
Puerto Rican issues are discussed in the Natural Resources Committee. So
talk about that.
Yeah, in Congress, whenever the topic of Puerto Rico comes up, it is discussed in the Natural Resources Committee. So there is this understanding that there was an acquisition of territory, but not necessarily an understanding that there had to be like some responsibility for the people. And that is why, like when we, I think that this has come up in several instances recently, like just in conversations or more so because of the pandemic, like online conversations and comments regarding how a landscape can be appreciated more, like an empty landscape can be more appreciated than like a people, or how this all overlaps with understandings of tourism and tourism promotion, and how being one of the few places where people can go during the pandemic can also be like something that's really shocking. Yeah. I mean, Puerto Rico is promoted as the place where you can you don't need a passport, just come, you know.
Bring your disease. God. Yeah. So when you're talking with Puerto Rican artists, like this is on the table, it's up front, it's like the top layer. There's no, I think in the United States, sometimes some artists have the luxury of seeing their art as outside of historical practice or history or apolitical. We can question all those ideas. But that's not like Puerto Rico, they're like, bring it. Can you, in thinking about that connection between like Puerto Rican history and art making and collaboration, can you take us a little bit through like what it means to like make art together in Puerto Rico? What does it mean to collaborate? Where and how it happens? What's the hustle around it?
I think it's a necessity. Collaboration is a necessity. It's not just that it can become like an economic necessity, but I think that it is a way of finding, depending on the artist, like finding family, finding community, understanding, like mutual understanding. And also on another level, there is an understanding that you can't do everything that you want to do. So you need to find other people that will, that maybe like, you know, someone has a camera, someone has a microphone, another person has the cable. Someone else like can be a producer, you know? So the way that the San Juan or like kind of the Puerto Rican delegation, I would say, is working is, you know, it's very much in tune with how things operate here. Even like I'm working in an institution, but like we are also constantly collaborating with other independent like projects that maybe like we have the fiscal sponsorship capability and they don't, so that we collaborate in that way so they can like distribute funds in some other way that may not be like exactly aligned with how we would distribute the funds, but it's just a way of trying to get the ball rolling, basically. Obviously the pandemic has kind of put a stop to many things and many projects, but there are some particular spaces that are like directly linked to certain artists or certain kinds of practices that have been very, very important in sustaining emotionally and even literally sustaining people. And that was very, very evident right after Hurricanes Irma and Maria a couple of years ago in 2017, where like literally like a local bar was the place where people would go to eat. And that was the place where people performed, and that was the place where people played or DJed or whatever. So there are these like spaces that hold people, and that is something that has, you know, evolved over time, like what place that is or what group of people, but it's important. It's important emotionally and economically.
Can you talk a little bit about like the nature and the feel of those bars in those places, or like Santurce?
Oh, I miss it. Yeah, this place in particular is called El Local. Uh-huh. I grew up in Old San Juan, and Old San Juan is very, very different right now from what it used to be when I was growing up. And my mom will say that it was very different when she was going there in the 1970s. I think that we have been losing some of that kind of authentic bar feel. I guess to like cocktails and stuff like that. The places that I want to like reminisce about in Old San Juan are more like these dive bars, or maybe like neighborhood bars, really, where people from the local community around it, like literally like a couple of blocks would go and meet and like hang out as neighbors. And then like some other people from outside of the city of Old San Juan would also come and like, and hang out and meet. And maybe there's a couple of other bars that would be open like late after 4 p.m. And then everybody that was still around and everybody that was coming off working at the other places would go to those other bars at 4 p.m., at 4 a.m. and stay there till like 6 or 7. And then in Santurce, Santurce used to be this kind of like theater and movie theater and theater district. A lot of it has changed or is kind of derelict, but it was well known for its Art Deco buildings. So it was like very 1940s, like glitz. And now I would say that a lot of the buildings are dilapidated. Not all, of course, but basically like the main avenue, which is Avenida Ponce de León, has this like patchwork of like really beautiful building, some of these companies, like some like co-working space, like renovated this building and it looks amazing. And then there's like derelict government building right next door, and like whole blocks of that, like beautiful apartments, and then like, you know, a dump. But it's this like architectural patchwork. And then there are these like kind of polar opposites of very, very expensive like dining cocktail places versus, I don't know, like mostly like Dominican bars or kind of like supermarket slash like bar places. And then there are places like La Respuesta or El Local, or in another neighborhood in Rio Piedras, there's Club 77, Club 77. And these are places that, like, when I was in my late teens and early 20s, like, literally, like, there were no actual venues with, like, good sound systems. And, like, I would go to punk shows in, like, weird pizza places or, like, literally, like, barbecue places in, I don't know, in the mountains. Like, I mean, when I say the mountains, it could be like just 20 minutes away.
Yeah.
It's an island. but then people a couple of years ago, over 10 years ago, started developing their own businesses because it was like, hey, like we need to get older and have our own venues so we can invite the bands we like and our friends can play. And it's not something that was unique to San Juan. It's not something that had not happened before. It was just that was how my generation started experiencing it. Like finally, the people that I knew were the venue owners, basically. And then that creates a sense of more, you know, like you're not dealing with like some random businessman. You're dealing with someone who is a colleague, a friend, someone who's also in a band. Someone who's also a performer, or then so you can go to a place where you feel like there can be like people serving you in the bar, and then they'll go and have to play. and I think that is something that has been really I don't know, like these most of these spaces are not like music exclusive places. They're like spaces for performance. They're spaces for showing art. El Local, for example, it has its own gallery space and like two backyards and like the main the main space where bands can play or drag shows can, you know, be performed. So there is an overlapping of scenes happening in the same places. And it's not, there's a lot of collaboration and love in that.
I'm thinking about when we first started thinking about who do we know in Puerto Rico? And I contacted Alex Hathaway, who was, I was trying to remember how I know Alex. I was at the University of Minnesota, and I would take undergraduate classes to clear my brain, and Alex was in them. So we would take classes together, and Alex was born in Puerto Rico, and I called him and was like, Alex, what do you think about, who do you know? And he's like, one, you must talk with Marina. And then he was like, El Local, and the El Local is like how you should learn, like how to think about what art and art practice and artists are in Puerto Rico. It didn't start with an individual, it started with a place, with a practice, which is different than any other place we traveled to.
Yeah, El Local has a really interesting history too. Like I'm not, you know, an expert, but there is actually even like a friend of ours even published a book about El Local, like stories from El Local. He's like a well-known investigative journalist actually. And the bar is not that old. It probably has over 10 years though. But it was first founded by a group of of women, some of whom are queer. And then I don't know, because I wasn't in Puerto Rico, I wasn't living in Puerto Rico at the time. I don't know exactly how it eventually changed hands, but they renovated the place. I think it used to be a travel agency at one time. So there was this huge like map of the world, like really old school, kind of like Soviet Union is here, you know? World map. And then But it was always a bar, and it was always a music venue, and it was also always a place where people could have art shows. I think that it was mostly art in the beginning, and then the main kind of exhibition space became the place where bands could play and people could perform. And then eventually they opened up another space right next door that is connected to the bar to have the official like gallery space. It's not, you know, it's not a place that really operates like it's a gallery, an art gallery, but it's always very receptive to people who are, that can work independently basically and like put up their shows.
Cynthia, any questions you have? We're getting close to time. We've stopped eating. It means lunch is over.
I still have
like, you gotta go.
Half a burnt sandwich.
I know, because we've been like, answer.
Yeah, I mean, I've been thinking a lot about what you're talking about, like how the spaces are holding people and the spaces are this like beautiful collaboration in and of themselves of all the different practices and ways that people are together. And I was thinking about how the Momentary is also working towards that, right? Like that is one of our goals. And thinking about how the festival really is trying to blend and create this like collage of like what it is to be in the US. And so I'm wondering too how when we're thinking about holding space for people and thinking about hosting, I was thinking about specifically with Puerto Rico and the kind of the complications between tourism and locals. I'm just wondering if there are any practices or like modes of thought when it comes to hosting that you all are thinking about, either whether it's for the festival or just across the board.
Because
it feels like a lot of the hosting that you're talking through right now is very much like for the community and it's of the community. And I think like that, this is kind of a hard question because I don't know how to answer either. But thinking about like, I mean, we've talked a lot about, right, how to host for us, like how are we going to host everyone coming to the festival? And so there's this way of like making people feel part of it, right? Which you were speaking to, right? Like,
yeah. What's a good Puerto Rican host do, Marina?
I just wanted to be clear that like there are a lot of things and a lot of coming to Puerto Rico and learning things from the artistic community, like learning Puerto Rican history or learning about the, you know, what it is to be here and what it entails. If you learn that from people within the artistic community, that is one thing. And that can be very, very different from what people outside of that realm will understand as true, as valid. And like, I consider myself part of a very particular bubble. so it's not like my opinions or my understanding of history or how I read history is necessarily, you know, what is being taught in school, mm-hmm. or what people usually learn or how people are usually kind of, you know, like instructed about what being a, you know, a colony is. So there are people who will say that we're not. There are people that are very, very much like, we want to be, you know, a state. And then there is another group of people that say like, well, why don't we stay in this limbo? This is fine, you know? So I just wanted to be clear about that because I'm speaking from a particular bubble to another,
you know, of course, particular
bubble. Yeah, and-
Bubble talk is what we should call it.
Bubble talk, yeah. And that has taken on a completely different meaning during the, you know, Corona, but, So not So you, like, you won't necessarily, like, people coming here won't necessarily get like this whole spiel from, you know, just a random person on the street. But there are some things that are just felt, you know? And I think that particularly during this, more so now that we're getting like really close to like spring break, there's been like some really like crazy stuff happening. I mean crazy stuff happening on both ends, like how people are responding locally to visitors and how visitors are acting. So there are some tensions. Issues that I think that Puerto Ricans have to deal with in general, in terms of like how they perceive certain kinds of visitors as well. And of course, there is also this thing, this kind of entitlement that sometimes people like come to Puerto Rico with, like, what are you talking about? Like, I can do whatever, this is America. Mm-hmm. So America can also be very, like, can be a very violent imposition as well, when it is used as a way to say, like, I can do whatever I want here because this is ours. Yeah. I don't know how to answer the question.
No, Marina, what are the name of the two sisters? Because I know they transform their names as a, like, an act of decolonization.
Mulowaye and Mapensi no no.
Yeah, see. And I remember, I mean, they're working in a neighborhood that clearly has like had upon, like imposed upon it, a manufacturing history, a neighborhood in which like schools have been purposefully moved out of, like all these things are happening there. And we're sitting at their table and one of them like goes out into the yard and comes back with a piece of fruit and like starts cutting it up and is like handing us slices. And we're just like talking about Puerto Rican history and their art and just eating this fruit out of the yard. And it was like that informal, like here's a gift from our land. And then like, it was so moving. But like, here's our history and we're gonna share both.
Yeah.
And that was like a crystallization of like what it meant to me, what it meant to host in Puerto Rico.
Yeah. Mulowaye and Mapensi no no are two sisters that can form this this duo, I guess, that it's called Las Nietas de no no, the granddaughters of no no. No no is their grandfather, and the grandfather and grandmother like gave them this, they inherited this plot of land. They have their house and they also have another space that they use for more as a studio, but also as a space to receive other artists and receive the community. They're also, it's in San Antón. It's a neighborhood of Carolina, which is a neighboring town. It's very close to San Juan, 20 minutes away, you know. Uh-huh. And San Antonio is particular because it is kind of rural and kind of industrial. Mm-hmm. So in this overlap is where the kind of, you know, silent violence happens, where things are imposed on a community that makes them be displaced, where when the school is removed, then people have to go away. The school closures, I think they started in 2015 as well. It's because like Puerto Rico has a shrinking tax base, people are moving away. There is also something else that is related to like hosting and guesting. And it's the fact that like economic crises have forced people to leave Puerto Rico, but then the government through their economic initiatives and incentives are incentivizing like US-based individuals, like high income individuals, to move to Puerto Rico. So like we are being kind of forced to host people that we don't really like. I mean, in the sense, and I say like we, because I think that this is not just my bubble. Yeah. I think this is in general. It's like, if I have to pay, you know, like a quarter of my salary in taxes, why would like Logan Paul, like that, like YouTuber guy, why would he pay 4% tax?
Yeah.
You know, like the luxury housing market is like through the roof, but I can't find a three bedroom that I can afford that is in decent condition as well, you know. So there is that dichotomy between like, how can this be a place that is livable, that is agreeable, that is good for us to live, that does not entail like creating these kind of like rich enclaves by the coast that displace other people, and that enables basically like entitled rich white guys to come and live here with their hedge funds and their, you know, and their like stock bros, like crypto bros, stock bros, influencer type bros. Yeah. And they're mostly men, which is another like kind of annoying thing.
Always.
Yeah, I mean because they come with certain expectations that are imposed on women and that result in things that we have already seen happening, like sexual violence, just an increase in like this kind of, you know, in sex workers, but not exactly the kind that I want to empower. I mean, it's not the kind of work, it's not the kind of situation that would lead me to say, yes, girl, you know.
Yeah. It's so, yeah. We'll wrap up. That's my dog alarm. But like, just what I love and want to thank you for is just speaking to that like layered history, reminding me of the care that we need to take with communities, and that care is like complex and historical and layered and full of story. And yeah, just thank you. Thanks for being with us today.
And I would say that is actually the key to, I've talked about this mostly with artists that work in video actually, or people that work in film. And they always talk about how like Puerto Rico has mostly like a documentary output, that people are like, so like, there's so much thirst for, you know, to get our history out there or to uncover certain things that people are very willing to speak.
Yep.
So yeah, I think that is part of our like hosting strategies, like try to, you know, get the word out there.
Yeah, my brain was tired when I left. It's like history. Well, all right. Have a beautiful rest of y'all's day.